item two, declarations of interest. Any members to declare the interest or party booking arrangements?
On item six, which is the local plan base, obviously I've been doing the local plan for the last few years, and more I just like to.
Okay, thank you, Lord. Any other?
Yeah.
Item three, appointment of vice chair. I would like to nominate councillor Christina Muscat to be vice chair.
I'll second that.
Do we need to vote on that? Will we all agree? Unanimous? Thank you very much. I don't know what the members code again, it's been done. Minutes to approve the act of minutes of the meeting held on 13th of March. Although I didn't sit on the committee, and as I said, wasn't chair. I have to assume those who are on the committee are saying the minutes lacking. Are you happy with me to sign that? Item six, core strategy local plan progress update. David Paul, I believe, is going to give us an update on this. Thanks, David.
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, members. Just a quick update on the local plan. First of all, in relation to the action plan that we submitted to the Secretary of State on the 5th of April 2019. The Council is still waiting a formal response from the Secretary of State to that action plan. So in the meantime, we're progressing along the timeline that's set out in that document. The monthly meetings with civil servants in the Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Government continue. They've been positive and constructive. What will also give us an opportunity to do is not just discuss the local plan, but also how we will deliver that. And therefore, we're making good links with organisations like Ports England, Department for Transport, and other central government agencies, and looking for funding opportunities regarding infrastructure and other matters. Just to remind you of the key dates for the local plan, which is set out in the action plan. The first of those is that we'll be bringing a report to Cabinet on the 25th of November, which will consider what's called the Regulation 18 plan. So that is the overarching vision, the strategic objectives. It will be assessing the options available to us, and we'll be recommending a preferred option. Subject then to the Cabinet agreeing that report, it will go to full Council for consideration on the 9th of December, and if that plan is approved by the Cabinet, then public consultation will commence on the Regulation 18 plan in January 2020. After Regulation 18, we have to go to Regulation 19, which is the detailed local plan, and that will be around July of next year. And then we will submit the plan for examination by an independent inspector in November 2020. All member briefings for the local plan were done, the first of those on the 10th of June, and I understand from members' responses to that was well received. I've sent out today to all councillors a series of further all member briefings between now and the end of November, so hopefully you all have got that and will be able to attend those events. One key one, if you are able to attend on the 25th of September, when RQC will be coming to talk to members about the local plan process. In terms of the evidence base, we continue to work intensively on that. That's primarily updating the information that we have, and all that will feed into the Regulation 18 document, which will come to you later in the year. The Local Plan Member Advisory Group, regular meetings of that group have now been set up following the local elections. That comprises of the leaders of each of the groups and also the Chair of Planning Committee, I understand, will be added to that group. That's going to meet on a fortnightly basis, and that will be used to discuss the various stages of the plan as it progresses. We've also had some discussions with the Chair of the Planning Committee about the way in which the Planning Committee can be involved in the local plan, and particularly how, at a later stage in the process, it can begin to look at the detailed development management policies, which once the plan has agreed the strategic direction, it will be those policies that will be used when the Council actually considers making decisions on future planning applications. So that work is progressing at the moment. And I think, Chair, that's a brief update for members of the committee.
Thank you, David. Any questions, members? Yes, David.
Good evening, David. I'm just pick up there, maybe I'm being a bit obtuse, but what's the rationale for having the Chair planning on this committee? It just seems possibly a conflict of interest.
But that was something I understand that the leaders wanted to do, because obviously the planning committee needs to be intimately connected to the work of the local plan. So there's no conflict of interest there. It's just an opportunity to make sure that all of the relevant members, both cabinet members and the chair of the appropriate committee, are fully involved in the process at each stage as it goes forward. It's an advisory group, so it doesn't make any decisions. The decisions are made by cabinet and full council in relation to the local plan.
Christina?
In terms of the local plan, that will set out the land use plan for all land in the borough. It won't distinguish between council owned land or privately owned land, because it is a land use plan. If the council wants to do anything with its land, as I understand it, then that will need to go through the appropriate approval processes, whether that's the cabinet member decision or whether that decision has to come to the cabinet to decide.
Could we have a definitive answer, please, on who actually makes the decision on the council land? Because over the course of the last 18 months, we've been told it's the cabinet member, it's the leader, it's the cabinet, it's full council, it's the ruling group. So the ruling group, I presume they meant it's full council, but that doesn't apply anymore. So I really feel we need to know, because there's quite a lot of council land that looks as if it's, at the moment, it's in the land that's being looked at. And I think we all need to know what that process is, please.
Okay, I'll try again to answer that. So, maybe legal colleagues, as I understand it, the local plan covers all of the land in the borough, whether it's council owned or privately owned. And the local plan is there to allocate land uses for the future, as the unity development plan does today. So that's your land use plan. If then the council has any intentions of selling land or doing something with the land that it owns, I understand that that needs to go through the council processes, which I think under certain circumstances can be the cabinet member under the delegated decision, or it
Chair. David, I think you said that we're still awaiting a response from the Secretary of State. Now, I'm not sure whether that's a cause for concern, but is there a particular date that we would need a response back by, please?
There isn't a specific date when we need a response by. What we're doing at the moment is just progressing with the action plan that we've submitted in keeping to the timescales that are set out in there. We have asked, when the Secretary of State is likely to respond formally to the Council, and the civil servants that we've spoken to, they can't give us a date for that at the moment, maybe because of other issues that he's currently dealing with. But as I say, in the meantime, we're just pressing on with the action plan. We're keeping the civil servants fully informed of that, and I don't think we can do any more under the current circumstances.
Thank you,
Chair. Will that impact on the programme if he is late with the response? Could that impact on the programme like you detailed for us tonight?
He could do, because he could respond to our action plan saying that he does not agree with the timescale that we set out in there, and in his view, the timescale could be reduced, and that would have an implication for the Council. We would have to cross that bridge when we came to it, because we don't know what his view is at this moment in time. As I say, I think the best position under what we are doing is sticking to the timescale in the action plan and progressing on that. If he did come back and say it could be shorter, I'm not sure he could do it any quicker, even if the government decided to intervene, because we've got a very tight timescale now to submission in November 2020.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
and talk about Brightonwood, there seems to be another spat that's run in the works, and we seem to be getting further and further away from Brightonwood, having been told over it's everything spied as good plans for Brightonwood. We're suddenly seeing an emerging picture here, and it kind of fills me with a bit of horror.
In terms of the action that you gave us, the recommendation that was carried in the January committee, we've taken advice and researched how we can utilise the existing bylaws for dog control matters. As you recall, there are effectively two bylaws that relate to dog dogs and control. One is to do with cemeteries, crematoria, and the second is to do with playgrounds. Now, our advice that we received, research we've undertaken, is that we can continue with bylaws in their existing way and enforcement in the way that they're set out. But we can't change them. The instrument that was there before to change bylaws has moved on. In fact, government recommendations are, if you want to tackle local issues, then you use that protection order. The current bylaws for cemeteries is that we prohibit dogs. We don't allow dogs in cemeteries at all. And that's been in place since the bylaw was introduced. However, as you all know, that is not enforced and it's not recognised. So dogs are going into our cemeteries. And a recommendation from 1984 was that the measure should be changed from prohibition to dogs on control under the or bylaws. As I said, the advice we've given is that we can't change our bylaws, so the current bylaw either continues or we do something else, but not change the bylaw. In terms of the playgrounds, that is an old bylaw. I think it was introduced in the mid-90s, and it specifies that Vicky was involved in doing that. So that means that the bylaw actually prescribes the facilities at the time. So that means any facility that was built or established after that is not included in the bylaw. So again, we've got something like 50% of our playgrounds covered by the bylaw, but 50% not, and we can't change that through the bylaw. So the recommendation it gave us, unfortunately, is not workable, or certainly in terms of changing it to something that we would like to take forward as a future control measure. And also, as the report says, there are a number of other facilities that we may consider that would be appropriate for dog control measures that aren't obviously through no bylaws. As I mentioned, the council is now taking time to decide a way forward for dog behaviour change and also be tackling violent crime. We're not ready to present to you this evening our proposals, but the intention is to present to you in the autumn with a set of proposals based on what we intend to do for driver behaviour change. That will include dog control measures or proposals for dog control measures, what we do in terms of moving forward. Again, expressed in March, the new approach not involved in the so-called robust approach to enforcement or zero tolerance, as it was called. We've always had an emphasis on education and public awareness campaigns, working with communities and providing advice, and consulting with stakeholders and interested groups. So that is the proposal. That's what we intend to do in terms of presenting to you in the autumn. How do we tackle environmental crime ultimately? Because environmental crime continues, I'm sure, as all councils will be telling you that environmental crime is continuing. How we ultimately tackle that is something we need to decide as a collective way forward. So, Chair, that's my update. Obviously, I'm happy to take questions about the way forward.
Thank you, Roger. Before I ask members to come, I'd just like to express a very concern with what you said. Intend to present in this committee in autumn. That certainly wasn't our understanding of the timeline. Myself and the spokes met with the cabinet member last week, and this was not indicated. She indicated she would go and consult over this, and yet you're telling us you're bringing something back. It's almost like, you know, go and consult, but we're not listening. We're going to bring something in autumn. So, I'd just like to put that in my role that I am concerned about that, as for the members now. Any members, any questions? Christina?
Yes, Mike, you and I spoke about this a long time ago, when it was first raised within the Labour group, and I expressed my concerns then about the votes going because I think we've got other ideas forward at Scrutiny. We certainly wanted a whole different perspective on how consultation is done. And as the chairs referred to at our chairs briefing, we also had other views. And it would seem that those views are going to be completely ignored. And we don't want it to fail again. And we don't want to fall into the trap again. And we want to take the people who are with us on whatever we decide to do. And we, I think, as I say, as chair, we have great concerns that that's not going to happen. Unless we look at this in a totally different way, we can't be seen to be laying down the law on things because people don't like it and they don't want it. We take people with them because they agree with what you're saying, or they see the reason why you're saying it. And I think we've got to totally move in this.
Yes.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to pick up on the point you made about the informal meeting that we held last week, and I particularly like to based on record my appreciation of the approach by Councillor Liz Gray to involve other party spokes in those informal discussions. I think it's a very positive way forward. One idea that I raised at that occasion was that I think we ought to take a far more conciliatory approach to this issue. Mike, you were talking about, you know, possibility of bringing back, you know, further ideas in the autumn. And the question of enforcement raised its head. I mean, last week I noticed a sign up on the entries near me saying people allowing their dogs to foul are liable to a fine of £1,000. Well, it's just nonsense sign. I mean, it's not going to happen, is it? And it seems to me that it would be much more effective, well, and worth experimenting. A softly approach where we make certain advisory areas dog free. Not that people are going to be fined and prosecuted, but just relying on people's goodwill and educating them. So in play areas, it's just like accepted that dogs don't go there. We don't need to police it. We don't need all the palaver for a kingdom sort of style approach, which proved so controversial last time. I think that would also mean we could operate without having to worry about updating bylaws which can't be changed. And I think a light touch approach might be a much more effective way, at least as an experiment. If it should fail, then we might need to come back and look at it again. But I would hope in the autumn we might look at those sort of ideas.
Would you like to respond to one of those two more?
Well, the first thing is, in terms of the point that you made, the next meeting is on the 24th of September, so yeah, that's, you know, that's the sort of time scale we can work towards. You know, that's the autumn. I'm not sure whether we're making after that. So that's the first issue. I mean, you know, we've said that we're very clear as a council we wanted to take time and consult. At the end, I said, those against any of the three councils, the three you've named, that we will. You know, take on board comments. Your role is obviously to scrutinise what is proposed. That's what I understand your role in this approach. And that's what we intend to present to you, a set of proposals. I don't think Councillor Graham, it will be a one size fits all thing. I think it will be a range of issues and a range of ideas that we'll bring back to you. But that's the approach we want to take.
I'm quite to hear what you said about education, and I agree with Alan. I fear that we're in danger of throwing a baby out with the bathwater, if you like, because it is an issue, and people, you know, it's an awful thing, isn't it, dog fouling? But obviously, Kingdom brought another side to it. It really is an emotive subject, but I think, yeah, softly approached, but equally, we've got to be very careful because. You know, we were talking earlier about children's play areas. The park by us has a small kids' area that's fenced off. I've noticed around, but there's lots of other small kids' play areas that aren't fenced off. The big kids' areas aren't fenced off, but there's dogs running in and out of there. You know, maybe if we had an approach where we literally ring fence these play areas, that would stop dogs going in because it's where, you know, it's where in Highbury Park where the kids' play area, there's no dogs around in there. is a must. But I just think we need to be a little bit more about this and realise it is an issue. The cemetery is one to me. We have a cemetery in Barrington, and you see elderly people with possibly the only companions about going to visit a grave, and they're not allowed in the cemetery. And it's just a bit, I understand being hamstrung because we can't change the Bible, so I appreciate it in a very difficult position, Mike. But I just think we need to be a little bit grown up about it and use many approaches rather than just, with the kingdom of Muhammad to crack it, walls. And I just think we need to look at the bigger picture, because everybody's got an opinion on it. Let's come together and, let's try things, but it's not going to happen overnight, not going to please everybody. So I appreciate the applause, and I agree with it, to be honest, and thank you for that, because I think the education side, that's more than anything else, I think the hamstrings, and I think you're trying to say and do very dodgy courses. So thank you, Chair.
Yes,
sir.
Thank you,
sir.
Just a question. What plans have you got then to consult with dog walkers and people in the community? Because you said you're coming back with a report by September, so I'm just aware that shouldn't be much time. But have you got any plans that you've got already in place? Thanks.
There are a range of well-known organisations back to the Wirral, and we intend to consult with them. We've got links with those organisations, and we'll use part of those links. So Wirral Good Dogs, those sort of organisations over here, they've made deputations to yourself previously as a committee, and we'll be consulting them. In terms of the full scale consultation, I'm not sure that's the intention in terms of coming back with proposals, but in terms of groups that represent dog walkers and dog owners, etc., we've got a framework that we can utilise for that.
Right.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. As I understand it, we're not being asked to make any decisions tonight at all on this, other than to note the fact that a report will be coming back. As I understand it, I think what's being said by Mike and others is that as a council, we're all being asked to take a deep breath, have a look at the situation, consult again, and then come back. If that's the situation, I'm happy with that. So I'm happy to wait for the recommendation to come back. It may well be then that we might have differences of opinions about where the emphasis should be, etc. But I'm happy, Chair, at the moment, to note the report that Mike's given, allow the further discussions, further consultations to take place, bring it back to this committee, and we'll decide then where we want to go. So if I've read it right, I'm happy to leave it on that basis.
Christina?
I'm not really happy to leave it. Only because what you said about the consultation, I find a little bit worrying, because there are so many other groups that need to be consulted with. I gave the example to some people before. If you go to Bromborough to Autism Together's cafe and shop, there's a notice there which asks dog owners to say one specific part, because the clients and the people who work there do have probably more fear of dogs than other people. So they're asked to, we're all asked as dog owners to respect that, and we do. Now, there's where the education comes in, because we're not just talking about dog muck. We're talking about educating people so we take them with us and show the other point of view, which is what we never did before. There are people who are frightened of dogs. There are people who are frightened of the illnesses that you can get from dogs. I mean, dog owners would probably think it's irrational, and they may well be wrong. I was totally opposed to the way it was done before, but I do feel that we do have to have some areas which are dog-free, and I don't think dog owners would argue that.